I want to tell you about exotic objects in topology. Before I do that, let me just tell you more generally what topologists do. We study geometric shapes, but unlike in ordinary geometry, we don't care about lengths, angles, areas, volumes. We don't care about any of that. We just care about what properties geometric shapes have that are unchanged when you deform them. And by deform, I mean you're allowed to bend it and twist it and stretch it as if it's made of an elastic material, but you're not allowed to break it.
So a square, for example, if we started manipulating that, it would very quickly not be a square anymore.
That's right. We have a square right here, and I could turn it into a circle, or more or less a circle, by just bending it. And I could also turn it into a triangle. But what I cannot do is turn, let's say, a circle into two circles. The only way to do this would be to break it and then glue it back, but that's not allowed. Similarly, I could have a ball and I could turn it into a cube. There's a saying that topologists are people who cannot tell apart donuts from coffee mugs. So for example, here is a donut and here is a coffee mug.
Oh, no.
I mean, they're the same. They're the same for us because you could deform one into the other. They both have this hole through them. But what I cannot do is turn the donut into a ball because the ball doesn't have a hole, so I don't want to punch a hole in it. That's not allowed. And, well, I could do that by taking a bite out of the donut, but we topologists are healthy people. We're not supposed to be eating donuts. The objects that we mostly care about are called manifolds. These are objects that look, from any given point, they look pretty much like flat space or n-dimensional hyperspace. What is n-dimensional hyperspace? In dimension one, we have a line. In dimension two, we have the plane. In dimension three, we have space. And then you can think about dimension four, just add another variable, say time, and that's four-dimensional hyperspace. And you can just add more variables, five-dimensional and six-dimensional, and so on. It's not something that we can visualize, but we can think of it mathematically anyway, and we can write down equations.
And so, manifolds sit in this space? Or are manifolds the space themselves?
They can sit in the space, but they could also look like that space around any point. So let me tell you an example. The surface of the Earth is a great example. It's a sphere, more or less. It's called a geoid. It has mountains and valleys. But remember, we can all deform them and make it into a sphere. Topologically, it's a sphere. And it sits in three-dimensional space. But around any point, it looks like two-dimensional plane because I can move in basically two directions. I can move left and right and forwards and backwards. There are 2 degrees of freedom. So that's what I'm saying, that the sphere is a two-dimensional manifold, even though it lives in three-dimensional space.
Okay.
Other examples of two-dimensional manifolds would be the surface of the donut or this famous Klein bottle. Yes, if I live on it, again, I wouldn't be able to tell the difference from a plane. Just like it's pretty hard to tell the difference between a plane and the Earth, the sphere, from where we are. To really tell them apart, you would have to go far away and see that you come back. There are also one-dimensional manifolds, like this circle right here. It's a one-dimensional manifold. If we only lived on the circle, then we would only have one direction in which to move in. And then there are three-dimensional manifolds, like our ordinary space or the universe. Around every point, it looks like we have three dimensions to go into. We also have the bottom and top. But we actually don't know the shape of the universe. It's a three-dimensional manifold. It could be hyperspace, but it could be what's called a three-dimensional hypersphere. Perhaps if we go very high up, then we would come back to where we are. Nobody has done that, but we don't know if it's possible or not. Just like on the surface of the Earth, when you go around, you come back. So we just know it's a three-dimensional manifold.
Is there no way to test for that? It seems strange that we could not know even the one we're living in, the one we're living and breathing in. That is the only way to test, to walk forever and see if I come back.
No, there are other ways. People are looking at cosmic microwave background radiation, and they have put forward various theories about what the shape of the universe is, but there is no definite theory that everyone accepts. It's not yet known what shape it is. But there are some hints from the universe. Okay, so we have three-dimensional objects, and then we can think about four-dimensionals and so on. A good example is this hypersphere. So in dimension one, we have the circle, which is a one-dimensional manifold, and it's the set of points at a given distance from the origin. It's given by the equation x squared plus y squared equals 1. Similarly, we have the sphere, which is, again, the set of points at distance 1 from a given point, but it lives in three-dimensional space, and it's given by the equation x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals 1. And we can generalize this. We can talk about the n-dimensional hypersphere, which is given by the equation x1 squared plus dot 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 plus xn squared plus another variable xn plus 1 squared equals 1. It lives in n plus 1 dimensional space, and it's an n-dimensional manifold. Now I'm getting to the crux of the matter, the exotic objects. What are exotic objects? These are things that are topologically the same but are smoothly different. So there are two ways of thinking about deformations in topology. I showed you before that a circle can be turned into a square, and in the process, of course, you have to make a corner. Now, the circle is smooth, and you can turn it into other smooth curves, like maybe something like an ellipse, and the process would be smooth. Now, could it be that we have two smooth objects, and you can deform one into the other, but the only way to do so is by making corners somewhere in the middle? Then those objects would be topologically the same, but smoothly different. And I don't know, if you're more familiar with one of the objects, you would say that the second one is an exotic copy of the other one. It's like if you live on the first object and you go to the second one, it's like going to an exotic vacation. Some things are the same, but some things are just different. Now, how can this be? How can you have two smooth things, but to deform one into the other, you need to make corners? Here is an example. We have a figure eight, and can I turn it into a circle? Well, I can do so if I make one of the loops smaller and smaller, but at some point I have to make a corner, and then it becomes a circle. Now, that's not actually a good example, because if I had a third dimension, if I allow myself to just lift this up, then it would become a circle just smoothly. So this is not a real example of exotic objects. In fact, I cannot show you exotic objects because they don't exist in dimensions 1, 2, and 3, in the dimensions that we can easily visualize. They only start existing in dimension 4 and higher. The first examples were found in 1956 by a mathematician called John Milner, and they were found in dimension 7. They are exotic hyperspheres of 7 dimensions. So there is some object, an exotic sphere, that you can deform into the ordinary seven-dimensional sphere, but not smoothly. An exotic sphere is a smooth object that I can deform into a sphere, but I cannot deform it smoothly. I would have to make corners in the middle. Let me show you now the numbers of spheres in each dimension. In dimension 1, 2, 3, there's just one, the standard one. The same goes in dimensions 5 and 6. Now, in dimension 7, we actually have 28 spheres. So there's the standard one, and then there are 27 different ones. Then we have 2 spheres in dimension 8, then 8, then 6. Then in dimension 11, we have 992 spheres. In dimension 12, we have just 1, then 3, then 2, then 16,256, and so on. If you look at the sequence of numbers, it looks strange, I grant you that, but there are some patterns. For example, in dimensions 7, 11, 15, every 4 dimensions, you get a lot more exotic spheres than in the other nearby dimensions. One thing you can ask is, in what dimensions do exotic spheres exist? And in what dimensions there's just the standard one? We see that there's just one sphere in dimensions 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 12. And also, mathematicians figured out the same is true in dimensions 56 and 61.
So does that mean if I was an object living in a 61-dimensional universe, it's a little bit more boring than some of the other ones?
That's right. Yes, these are the boring dimensions. You don't have exotic spheres. Although you do have some other exotic objects in these dimensions, just not spheres.
These numbers seem so arbitrary. I assume it's impossible for someone to easily explain why it's certain numbers that are boring and other ones that are hyper-exotic.
These numbers are hard to compute. There's a whole story involving Bernoulli numbers and homotopy groups of spheres. The most interesting thing about them is that we can compute them in any dimension except in dimension 4. That's where I left a question mark. That's the biggest mystery. It's one of the most famous open problems in topology. It's called the four-dimensional smooth Poincaré conjecture, which says that there are no exotic spheres in dimension 4.
But we don't know that for sure yet.
We don't know. There are examples of objects that are smooth, and you can deform them into the ordinary four-dimensional sphere by introducing corners, but people don't know if you can do that smoothly or not. I have also looked for exotic four-dimensional sphere myself, and I couldn't find any.
If you did, would you become a very famous mathematician?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Would you, it's not like a millennium problem, is it, or anything, or is it?
No, there was a similar conjecture in dimension 3, the Poincaré conjecture. That was the one problem in topology among my millennium problems. That was solved by Perelman in 2003. And I think now the most famous remaining open problem in topology is this one about dimension 4, but it hasn't yet made it to the list of millennium problems.
Professor, don't waste your time making number file videos. You need to go upstairs and solve this problem.
Number file videos are important too.
All right. So why is dimension 4 so difficult?
Good question. Well, it's more difficult than the lower dimensions, 1, 2, 3, because in those dimensions we can see things. And there are also geometric techniques that mathematicians use to study shapes in these dimensions. What's interesting is that it's also simpler than dimensions 5, 6, and greater. And the reason for that is a trick about separating disks. To explain it, let me say one way in which topologists distinguish between shapes. If I have a lasso and I throw it somewhere on the plane or even on the surface of the Earth, which is a sphere, it would surround a region. So I could just contract it into a blob around a little point. But if I have the same lasso and I would put it around the surface, around a hole in a donut, then I wouldn't be able to contract it without breaking the donut. And that's one way you can tell the donut apart from the sphere. So to study these objects, mathematicians are looking at loops and how you contract them. And the contraction spans a disk. A disk is a two-dimensional object. And it's easier to study these objects if you can split apart the disks so that you can study each complication one at a time. All right, how can you split apart disks? Well, let me start with lines. If I have two lines, and they're on the plane, and they intersect, if I move one a little bit, I'm not going to be able to take it off the other. But I can take it off if I allow myself to go into space. The reason is that 3 is greater than 1 plus 1. Each line is a one-dimensional object, and 1 plus 1 is 2, but I have one extra dimension. And that's why I can do it. Similarly, if I'm interested in separating disks, each disk is a two-dimensional object, and 2 plus 2 is 4, so I need one extra dimension. So in dimensions 5 and higher, I can separate disks, and that just makes topological objects easier to study. This is called the Whitney trick, and it led to the classification of smooth manifolds in higher dimensions back in the 60s.
And this is the problem with dimension 4. You can't, in dimension 4, you haven't got the space to separate two disks.
That's right. We don't have the geometric methods from lower dimensions, and we don't have the trick about separating disks. And that makes dimension 4 the hardest to wrap our heads around. To give you an example of something that's unique to dimension 4, instead of looking at exotic spheres, let's look at exotic hyperspaces. Remember, we had the line, and then the plane, and then the space, and in n dimensions, we have the hyperspace. So could you have an exotic hyperspace? Something that looks like a plane or a space, and you can deform it into the ordinary one, but only by making corners. Here are the numbers of hyperspaces in each dimension. In any dimension except 4, there is just one. There's just the standard one, and there are no exotic hyperspaces. But in dimension 4, we have infinitely many. In fact, it's more than infinitely many. It's uncountably many. It's not the kind of infinity that you can count, 1, 2, 3, and so on. It's as many exotic hyperspaces as there are real numbers. And this doesn't happen in any other dimensions. If you have exotic objects in some other dimensions, you know that there are always finitely many of them. There's finitely many exotic spheres, as I showed you that list of numbers. But in dimension 4, you can have infinitely many exotic objects. And yeah, that's what makes dimension 4 so fascinating.
Does this mean dimension four is something that you should be spending more time on because it's so special? Or is this a sign that maybe this is a bit of an aberration that you should leave alone? It's a place where you shouldn't play.
That depends on your perspective. There are mathematicians who work on the other dimensions, and there are mathematicians that work on dimension four. I'm in the latter category.
Because quite often when I speak to number theorists and they talk to me about prime numbers and they're showing me some interesting property of prime numbers, they very often discard two. They say, we're not going to use two because that's an aberration and it ruins everything. It ruins all our laws and principles and that, and they just throw it aside. It sounds like the fourth dimension is your equivalent.
That's pretty much it. In many theorems, you say this is happening in all dimensions except four, and we understand what's happening, and we just don't know what's happening in dimension four. But I find that interesting and worthy of study.